Ever wonder how to create lasting employee and management commitments? How to reduce the talent gap that is plaguing all of us? And how to do this with resilience? Our next speaker, Malcolm Harkins from Cymatic, will be speaking to us on I Believe, I Belong, I Matter, Solving the Cyber Risk Talent Gap. Malcolm.
Thank you. So you guys don't mind, I tend to walk, so I'm gonna step down here because I'm a pacer. The purpose of this dialogue is started actually a little bit more of a self-exploration with me almost 30 years ago. I've managed teams for 30 plus years. And I'm also odd relative to, I think, many of the people in the industry, because I've also only worked for three companies in 28 years. I worked for Intel for 24, straight out of graduate school. Then I went to Cylance Corporation for 4 years that was acquired by BlackBerry about a year ago. And then I recently joined a very early stage cybersecurity startup called Cymatic. And one of the things I learned a long time ago, more out of luck than actually, you know, architected, but I never had in any organization I was in, whether it's finance, procurement, business operations, before I tripped my way into security after Code Red and NIMDA and 9/11 in 2001. But I've never had a talent shortage. I've never had a talent gap. I've never had a problem recruiting and retaining people. And as I stepped back and thought about why and where I had performance issues, where I wasn't engaged, where I had these problems, I came up with this framework, six simple words. And I'll explain it to you as we go along. But my premise is our leadership gap that we have in this industry is contributing to the skills gap. National Association of Corporate Directors, in December of last year, 61% of the directors of public companies have said they'd compromise on cybersecurity for business objective. Appalling, considering the state that we're currently in. Cyber professionals, Life and Times, ESG, ISSA did this as well. 36% of us are attracted to the job because of the morality, the social responsibility, the mission, the purpose. We've got 60% of us that aren't satisfied with their jobs. 91% of us say that our organizations are extremely vulnerable. And what's our job? To manage that vulnerability. And then 56% say inadequate engagement with the board. Well, hell, if most of the board want to compromise on cybersecurity, well, yeah, there we go, lack of engagement. And almost 40% of us in the CISO ranks change their jobs because of a lack of culture in cybersecurity. That's a leadership gap. Both at the company and organizational level, but more specifically in the leaders who are running security in your organizations. How many of you are what I'd say a practitioner, an in-house InfoSec person? Okay, the rest of you in the management consulting or vendor side of it? All right. Now, I've also worked for cybersecurity companies, and I've said this at RSA for years. People don't like me saying it, but you shouldn't trust the cybersecurity industry. Why? Because all of those people on the floor profit from the insecurity of computing. So they have no economic incentive to solve the problem, because the more risk and more cost that exist for us, the more profits exist for the industry. So you also have to think about it with respect to even the people that you're associating with and whether or not their mission is to really help you achieve yours. I love the statement from Colin Powell, the day a soldier stops bringing you their problems is the day you stop leading them. They either have lost confidence that you can help or concluded you don't care. Either case is a failure of leadership. If 61% of the corporate board say they would compromise on cybersecurity, why would you go to them with a cybersecurity problem? You wouldn't. So the question is, what is leadership? And I've taught a lot of leadership classes over the years when I was at Intel, and one of the ones that I've spent a lot of time on is a leadership curriculum called the Leadership Challenge. Kuznets and Posner, when they were professors at Santa Clara University, had created it. And this definition for me was the best one I ever found for leadership. Leadership is the art of motivating others, mobilizing others to want to struggle for shared aspirations. It's a struggle. And we've got to get our teams, our people, our organizations to understand why this matters, and then keep us healthy in moving towards what we need to do to manage and mitigate risk. But how do you do this? How do you attract and retain? How do you get people to that ideal state? Again, Carolyn mentioned earlier about burnout. We don't want them burnt out, but we want them committed, right? And they need to struggle with that, and we need to show them the way to do it. This video here that I'm going to start, Kyle Maynard, you can see from this picture here, he was born with no arms and no legs. And he always wanted to learn how to wrestle. He wanted to learn how to wrestle. And he lost over and over and over again because of the physical challenges that he had. But those physical challenges created a mental barrier. Now, what happened is when he was in eighth grade, he finally pinned somebody. And he was stunned by it. He let him go. And then he pinned him again. And he let him go. And he pinned him again and pinned him again. Until finally the referee, out of the mercy law, declared him the winner. He then went on through high school and won 135 consecutive matches, 12th ranked in the nation in wrestling. He's climbed Mount Kilimanjaro. He's done MMA. This is somebody who really knew what it took to believe in themselves. Again, Carolyn talked about it. She needed to feel good about herself, right? And when I've looked at performance problems and I've looked at turnover and all those things in any organization I've run, I've generally found that if there's a problem, one of these elements of I believe, I belong, or I matter is missing. And I'll explain what that looks like as I go through this further. But when somebody believes in something, they have a sense of purpose, no limits. Again, they demonstrate conviction. That's a force multiplier. If you got a small amount of people, they got to punch above their weight limit. That's our job as managers and leaders, to teach them how to do that, to instill the fact that we believe in them and we're there to help them. Now, when you look at this and you start thinking about it and you put it in the context of a company, if you don't believe in the messenger, you can't believe the message. You can't believe in the messenger if you don't know what the messenger believes. And you can't be the messenger until you're clear about what you believe. It's why I constantly am transmitting all the time, internally and externally, what I believe and why I believe it. People believe what I believe, they lean in on it. If they don't believe what I believe, I know where the battle is and I know how to fight it. And my team witnesses me doing that. You know, we've got to go to a point where we have people, we listen to what people say, but we watch what they do. Right? Board saying cybersecurity is important. 60% of them are going to compromise on it. What they say versus what they do. From the top down. How many of you have been in organizations where, again, with the CEO, the CIO, some C-level exec says cybersecurity is important, right? Annual training and awareness day. Somebody does their two-minute spiel, and then they go right back to their office and screw it all up because they actually don't really give a shit. I belong. I love this video. Steve Adazio, last time I actually did this in Boston at Keane's event, the day before he had just been released as the head of Boston College coach, but is a fantastic video clip.
Here we are, right at that juncture right now. Got an opportunity to write a new script. But off an old tablet, BC football, throughout the country been known as tough football. High character, classy, physical, tough, rugged football program. Got a chance right now to rewrite that slate. To go back and pay back the guys that came before you. The way it's supposed to be done. Got a chance to set that right now. Got a chance to go out there and show the BC Nation and to show America just who you want to be and who you are. That's all you can ask for. Give me a chance to stand on that field and play. Give me a chance to play with my heart. Give me a chance to play for my teammates. Give me a chance to play for BC. That's all you can ask for. You've got that platform. Now, what we have to do is we got to play 60 minutes, 4 to 6 seconds relentless. We got to fly around the field. We got to have a lot of juice. The coaches will be flying around. You'll be flying around. We're playing as a team. We're playing as a team. We're 100 and whatever strong. That's what we are. We're BC. We're BC. It's not just about 11 on the field at one time. This program is not built on that. This program is built on the whole family together fighting for each other. Fighting for each other. That's what we're doing. You're accountable to your teammate. You're accountable for that. You don't give in and you don't lack effort because you're accountable to your teammate. And when we press play on Sunday, we're going to see a team flying around 100 miles an hour. You got to come off, get the next guy in. Repeat it after me, man. The team.
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 The family.
The family.
The family.
The family.
The family.
The family.
BC.
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 That's a guy who knows how to get people to feel like they belong. How many of you in your organizations, particularly if you're an in-house security team, your CISO, your CSO, is that fired up? Has you that accountable for each other? Has you understanding you are all working together for a common mission? And then that company, that organization you're supporting, cares about that mission too. You're laughing. You don't see it, do you? You very rarely see that. What I've always tried to instill in the organizations that I've had is that I'm on a different field. I've always believed there's two battlefields a CISO has. There's the external battlefield of the threat actors, threat agents, but then there's the internal battlefield of budgets, bureaucracies, and behaviors. I'm a former finance guy. I knew how to fight on that internal battlefield so my teams could go fight on the external one. Right? They had to be accountable to each other. I had to be accountable to them. And when you're there, you're connected, you're cared for, you can be your authentic self. Again, getting back to some of the dialogues that we heard earlier, and even the prior discussion. I have a middle son who's 23 who's got Asperger's syndrome, so high-functioning autism spectrum disorder. He always struggled to feel like he belonged, right? Again, if we do these things, we will be able to attract that talent. We won't have the discrimination against talent because we'll allow and attract people of different backgrounds, different perspectives, but all with a common goal, all with a common purpose. Now, when you get into this I belong stuff, if you don't belong, you can't create a sense of belonging. So if the CISO doesn't feel like they belong because they don't have the connection to the organization, they know the board is going to compromise on things, and they're leaving because of corporate culture. If they don't belong, how are they going to make their team feel like they belong? Right? It's a leadership problem that the CISO needs to solve. You can't belong if you don't have a relationship with others. Again, one of my pet peeves, we used to be the office of no, now everybody's kissing everybody's ass and saying they're the office of yes. I'm like, you can't do that. You got to find a middle way. Sometimes it's hell no, not on my watch. Right? And you can't belong until you have a shared purpose. Shared purpose with the organization you're supporting, shared purpose with the IT team, shared purpose with your organization in every aspect of the security jobs they're doing. Got to throw in an Oprah thing.
I can tell you that every single person I've ever talked to, whether they were victims of violence or the person who committed the violence, whether they were celebrities or whether they were going through difficult times in their life. When I finished the interview, almost to a person, at some point, one would lean into me and say, was that okay?
Is that okay?
Was that okay? Was I all right?
Is that all right?
Even Beyonce and all her Beyonce-ness. at the end of a performance where she was as Beyonce as you could get, leaned in and said, was that okay? And what I learned in all those thousands of interviews is that there's a common denominator in the human experience that we all share. We all want to know that what we do and what we say and who we are matters. We want to be validated. Every single person, in every single confrontation, every single encounter that you have, whether it's with the guy at the supermarket or in the toll booth or your boss or your children, every argument is really about, do you see me? Do you see me? Does what I say mean anything to you? Do I matter to you?
Do I matter? Again, if you have the disconnect between the organization saying it's important and the board's willing to compromise, you've got the CISO who's turning over every, depending upon the study, 2 years, 3 years, whatever. How do you have stickiness to a purpose? How does that organization, how do the people that are doing the work, the real people in the SOC, the security engineering, how do they know that somebody gives a shit about what they're doing? Unless you're engaged with them. And you demonstrate it all the way through. And when people feel like they matter and what they're working on matters, they're validated, they're confident. Again, they're seen, they're visible. And if you don't matter, you can't help others feel like they matter. So if you've got a CISO who's changing jobs every few years, who feels like the board doesn't really care, do they matter? No. I don't care if they have to fake it. They have to demonstrate for their team that their team matters, regardless of whether or not they do. But they have to find that spot where they matter. And to matter, you have to see and be seen. You have to have relevancy with the business. And you can't see if you don't know what really matters to you, which again gets back to purpose. Why are you there? What is the mission of the security team? How does that connect to the broader organization? Again, when I started working on this material for a future book, that's will be called I Believe I Belong, I Matter, The Art of Curating Commitment in Yourself and Others, I started looking for examples of it in history. And we're all familiar with the Martin Luther King speech, but you look at it, dream, hope, faith, I believe, we all belong. Mountain of despair to a stone of hope, to be a great nation. That's something that matters. Again, you can look at iconic things out there that we all get inspired by, and I can tease out these I believe, I belong, I matter elements. When you do these things and you create a culture like this, it's like having them in a Venn diagram. And when you're managing it this way and your team is continuing to grow and curate this across the entire organization, every employee is in their ideal state. Now, what happens when these things get done well, again, you feel fulfilled. You know, in the family setting, a longer version of this I do that has a lot more personal stories in it. You know, the same thing applies in personal relationships and families. But on the business side, you get stronger execution and stronger results. You know, when somebody's lacking in belief, they're lacking in hope, right? So if you diagnose a problem and somebody's just kind of mired, they're lacking in hope. They might be burnt out, again, getting to what Carolyn talked about this morning, depressed. They need a sense of purpose. You know, if you're a manager, you got to get them small wins. Reestablish that belief in themselves, belief in their management. You know, I'm a simple guy, so I always do what I believe, do it where I belong, do it because it matters. I want to go into work every day or some routine basis and be able to say and have all of my employees say, I believe in the mission, I believe in the management, I believe in my team, I believe in myself. I feel like I belong because somebody cares about me, and the work I do and the work the broader organization does matters. If you create that type of culture, like I've tried to do in every organization, I've never had a talent shortage. I've never had a talent gap. I have more people apply for jobs than I have jobs. And I don't have to spend money on a headhunter to go get them. I belong. If somebody's not feeling like they belong, they're lacking a connection. They start to become a bit of a loner, right? How many security folks out there that we see are kind of in this state? They need somebody to care, right? Take the time. They need to participate in something meaningful, right? Rotate them out of something that's mundane and boring. Giving them a side strategic project. It's extra work, but guess what? If somebody's not feeling like they're belonging and you can give them something like that, they're gonna know you care. They're gonna have more meaningful work. They're gonna have more purpose. And when somebody's lacking in the feel like what they're doing matters, what the organization does matters, it's lacking impact. Right? They might lose self-confidence and have repeat failures. They need to improve execution. Some of this is certainly skills and focus. But I believe if you hire smart people, I hire for three criteria: hungry, humble, and smart. If they're smart, they'll learn it. Getting back to the dialogues that we had earlier, who cares if they have a high school diploma or not? If they're smart, they're hungry, they'll learn. And again, when you do these things and you manage them together, you're in an ideal state. Now, I took out of some of this material what happens when these things get supersized, because they need to be in proportion to each other. If you've got I believe is, you know, a couple standard deviations above the others, you've got a fanatic. And fanatics are kind of cool, but they're also a pain in the ass. Right, so you can play with this in different ways. But for me, purpose and clarity have always been the force multipliers. Again, getting back to transmitting what I believe, why I believe it. And for me, that came about at Intel well over 10 years ago. First time I was getting ready to give a board presentation, and I had 30 minutes to tell them everything about information security and risk. And so I had to start getting really, really pithy. And I used to have a mission statement: information security, safeguard information security assets, blah, 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 bullshit statement that I could never remember. And then as I was working to get pithy, I'm like, what are we here for? Why do we exist? And it came to me, if we're not protecting to enable people, data, and the business, we're getting in the way. We're wasting money. We're wasting time. And as soon as I flipped the mission around, guess what? The organization in IT, the business and everything, saw us as part of the business. Our mission had relevancy to the company. And therefore, my team felt like they belonged more. They felt like they mattered more, right? And so, again, getting clarity on that purpose. I love quotes. This one from John Quincy Adams: if your actions inspire others to dream more, learn more, and do more, you're a leader. That's something that I strongly believe in. From the first time I ever got a management job, which wasn't planned, I was managing a call center for May department stores a few weeks after I got out of undergraduate. Temporarily, I was an hourly employee, clocking in and out, $6 an hour. But the management team would leave this call center. It was taking 10, 15, 20,000 calls a day. When I would show up after school, management team would go to lunch, and I would cover for the hour and some. And one weekend, in the basement of this May department stores, a gentleman comes down into the call center. I call security, figuring his customer got lost, and go over to him. He gets escorted out. I'm on this raised podium overlooking this call bank. About a half an hour later, management team still out for lunch. The vice president, assistant chief financial officer is coming down the escalator. He's coming down the escalator with this guy in golf shirt and khakis. And I'm like, okay, great. And then he walks up to the podium. I hang up an escalation call. And I was like, hi, can I help you? And Bill Howell, the vice president's like, hi, Malcolm, I'd like to introduce you to Edgar Mangiafico, the chairman of May Department Stores. And I was like, oh, great. Well, we're busy. Calls are backing up because you guys are distracting everybody. If you want to sit time in the call center, book an appointment, and I'll get the hell out. I kicked them out. It's 21 years old. I didn't give a shit. And they're looking at me kind of dumbfounded. And I was like, you can go now. You're screwing up my business that I'm here to run for an hour while all these other people are out to lunch. I come in the next morning on Monday afternoon after school, clock in, and management team starts to leave. The director used to give me like a 5-minute brief. Here's a few calls to go handle and follow up and stuff. And he wasn't around. And Bill's admin kind of runs out, and he had this big glass office overlooking the call center. And she's like, hey, Malcolm, Bill wants to chat with you. And I'm like, okay, well, everybody's leaving. There's nobody manning the ship. Okay, fine, whatever. So I go into his office, like, Bill, I was like, there's nobody out there running this thing. Calls are starting to back up. And by the way, the director's name, his name was Bill too. But I was like, where's Bill? He didn't give me a handover to cover for the next 90 minutes while they're all out to lunch. And he's like, that's what I want to talk to you about. And I was like, well, what? And he's like, I fired him this morning. I was like, oh, okay, well, why do you want to talk to me? He's like, because I want you to run that thing. I was like, the call center? He's like, yeah. And I'm like, when? He's like, when you go back out there. And I was like, okay. He goes, yeah, any questions? And I didn't even ask him how much I was going to make. And I said, no, I don't have any questions, but I have two requirements. I said, one, there was a woman who was between him and the director. And that call center, she verbally whipped people every time we got backed up on calls, would come out and just yell and scream at them and berate them. I said, one, she's not allowed on my floor. She's not allowed to talk to my employees. Rule number one, we good on that? And I said, and I realize I'll report to her. And he's like, yep, that's good. I'll go take care of that. And he goes, anything else? I said, yeah, rule number two, we get backed up on calls. I want every senior leader manager to grab a headset, a pad of paper, and plug in onto the desk and take calls, unless they're doing something critical. And I want it done in 5 minutes or less. And I'm going to get a timer, and I'm going to turn that time on. And you guys are all going to get your ass on the phone bank next to these people making $6 an hour to help so that we don't get crushed with calls. Because once you get behind on the call volume, you can't get uncover from it. And he's like, okay, anything else? I said, and rule number three is rule number one applies to rule number two. She is not allowed on that floor. Swear to God. And so 3 hours later, start to get into the early evening, people come home, they get their bills, they go into the store to shop, they've got all these problems and questions with their credit, and we start to get crushed. Pick up a call, call his office. Within the time, he gets a headset, plugs back in. All the management team plugs in. The woman is looking through her glass-walled office just wanting to throw daggers at me because she wasn't allowed on my floor because he'd already talked to her. And literally, the fastest time we had ever gotten on top of that call volume, we did it in about 25 minutes. That normally would have taken 2.5 hours with about a 30% call abandon rate. And we had a 5% call abandon rate, and we did it in 20-some minutes. And that's where I first started realizing this. These $6 an hour employees plugged in, when you had a vice president, you had other senior managers sitting next to them and saying, hey, how do I do this? Right? They felt like they mattered. You know, and when I asked Bill later, I was like, why did you want me for this and why did you fire the other guy? He goes, you understood the mission. You understood the mission was to serve those customers so their satisfaction was higher, and in doing that, you would increase and manage our revenue. He goes, you were right to kick us out, and very few people would have ever had the gall to do that. I was 21. The guy who was leading that was 42. All of the other management chain was in their 30s. I basically leapt over everybody because I had the backbone to say, don't screw up the mission of this team because I know what matters. I believe in it, and I make these people feel like they belong. And because I had been a call center agent next to them for several months, they all knew that I really believed in what they were doing. They had second jobs, they were in school, you know, they were trying to pay off college bills, and they were working part-time, some full-time. But I wanted them to realize that the work that they were doing, even though it was minimum wage, mattered. Again, for me, the I believe I belong, I matter is how I've, from that day, even though it was 20 years later, when I really started reflecting back on why I've never had a talent gap, why I've never had a shortage, why I've always been able to attain and attract and retain people in my organizations, is because of this framework. Now, on how you apply this, be clear on what you believe, share it, role model it. Figure out if you don't belong, and then figure out how to belong. Find a shared purpose. Create broad relationships. Even if you don't feel like you belong with CEO and board, find another executive in the company that can be a champion for you. Because that will give you your energy as a leader and manager. And then do it because it matters. Don't do the things that don't make a difference. And then spend time seeing and recognizing others in your organization. Thank you. We probably have a minute or so for questions. Otherwise, I'll probably be outside as well for a while.